Amen. Father, I thank you for your presence. I thank you for your grace. I thank you for your love. And I just pray that you will bless each and every one of us here today. I pray that you will bless us with your word. I pray that you will bless us with more of your presence. I pray that you will bless us with touching our hearts with your spirit, so that your word will bear fruit in our lives, Father. We thank you, we love you, we adore you, we worship you, because you are our God, and you are worthy to be praised, you're worthy to be honored, you're worthy everything, Father. So we thank you, and we praise you, and we bless your name. And we open our hearts to receive everything that you have for us today, in the name of Jesus. Amen. Is everything working? Good. Amen. Last time, I talked about being on fire for Jesus. Because God wants you to be on fire. Not a bad fire. Not burning up. But a good fire. The fire of His Spirit. In your life. Amen.
Amen.
Glorifying you. Making you passionate for Him and His glory. Amen.
Amen.
But I'm not going to preach that again. Today I want to talk about God being a consuming fire. Because the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 12. Verse 28 and 29. Therefore, since we are receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken, let us give thanks by which we offer to God an acceptable worship with reverence and awe. For indeed, our God is a consuming fire.
ዘይተንቀጥቅጥ መንግስቲ እንቅበል ካኮናስ ናአምላህ ዘሕጉሶ ዘሕጉሶ ቅዱስ ምክባርን ብፍርሃትን እናገልገልና ነመስግን አሜን
So God
ስለዚህ አምላህ
is a consuming fire
ዝባላ ሐዊ
And therefore
ስለዚህ
we should worship him with reverence and awe
በምክባርን ምፍራህን
Amen.
Amen.
You know, God is not a little toy. He's not a small God. He's not just a, you know, a wimp, a coward. God is a powerful God. A mighty God. He's great. And He's worthy of praise. He's worthy of our reverence. Because God is a consuming fire. And I want to talk to you today about what that means. So first we will go to Deuteronomy chapter 4 because this is the place where this quote is taken from. And it says in chapter 4, verse 24, For the Lord our God is a devouring fire, a jealous God. So number one, that God is a consuming fire means that God is a jealous God. Normally we connect jealousy with something negative. But you can be jealous in a positive way also. And when it comes to God, that He is a jealous God, there's no better word to translate it from Hebrew into English. But that means that God is a passionate God.
Amen.
Amen. God is full of passion.
Passion kami lah kami tutur kami fadil. Ini temasat atau way temasat. Galas bertigrinya temasat malati.
And that is, you know, he's passionate when he's loving.
Kamu ainat zulu wahai sepasion itu kamu ikat temasat zulu. Zafikar itu dah awin kafir setelah kali.
But he's also passionate when he's getting angry.
Dengan keakharah kalau hari kamu temasat pun engkau temui malati.
God is not a cold, calm God.
Amlah kami hidup sebagai fajar amlah.
He's a God on fire. He's burning. He's passionate. And that's the way He loves you. But that's also the way He's angry when something is making Him angry. Amen.
Amen.
It also means that God is uncompromising. God is not a God of compromise. He's not a God that you can, you know, try to
bribe.
But he's fully uncompromised. It also means that God is a fully engaged God. When God is into something, He's really into it. He's investing in it.
Amen.
Amen. When God has chosen a people, Israel, He engaged with them. He invested in that relationship. He wasn't just treating it like something, well, we'll see what happens. But God was determined to be their God. Amen.
Amen.
And you know, it's the same way. That's the way God is viewing a marriage. When you are married, you are supposed to be engaged with each other, investing in that relationship.
Amen.
You're not just getting married and then, well, that's my wife, and then you don't really care. No! You have committed to that person. You've made a promise before God to that person. You're supposed to be faithful. You're supposed to be loving. You're supposed to be actively engaging in that relationship. And it's the same with God. He's a jealous God. That means that He is a fully engaged God. Amen. Are you getting this? Amen. So, what does the Bible say about God being a jealous God?
ስለዚህ መጽሐፍ ቅዱስና ዛው አምላክና አቡካኑ ታይዘው
Number 1
ወጻሐደ
God being jealous is connected to his demand for exclusivity that he's that we're supposed to worship him and only him
እዚ ታይዝ ጎብሮ አምላክና እግዚአብሔር ከመስ ታይቀልባል ማለት እግዚአብሔር ንሱ ንበይሉ ከመላህ ዘለው አምላክ መሃኑ ይጠለብ ዝገብር ካባናስ እሱ ይጽበይ ይጠልብ ማለት
God is in one way an exclusive God
ስለዚህ አምላክ ንሱ በይሉ በሐል ነገር
When you have chosen to follow him
ንክትሰቦ እንደሐር መንስካ ወይ ወሲካ
He is not pleased if you're trying to you know get other gods and looking other ways
and the her nam karot amalakht kha tusakon ka we ka halot un entel le muhabzeku hukku sa yfawlen ziyabero yekbalon
the first commandment
taham taqaddam yitfazal
is that you should have no other god beside me
akademe kalot amalakht i have lu khant yitfazal
that's the first thing god says to them
ታመጀመርታን ህዝብ ተዛረባ እግዚአብሔር ባል ዘያ
when they have made this agreement that God should be their God and Israel should be his people
እግዚአብሔር አምላኩን ቆውል እስራኤል ከህዝቡን ሁሉን ኪዳን ተጣጣቶ
number 1 no other god
ታዳሚ ተላከኝ ካሉት አማልክት ያንዱኻ
because God is a jealous God
ናቱ አምላክ ከነ አምላክ
and he wants you alone
በይን ኸይስ ደለከን አኸ
amen It's the same like in a marriage again.
ንከከምቲ አቃል ኪዳን ዘበለ ያመረዓ ዘለው ከሙ ይ
When you are married, you're not supposed to run after other girls or other men.
ካልወተ ለቀንስተው ካልተከረባቸው ከደሊ አይተወለኒካ ማለት ይብል ሀይ
Right?
Okay.
You made a choice.
መሪስተኻ
It's only one now.
ሐንተ ወይና
And it's the same with God.
አምላክ ከሙ ይ
God says you should have no other god beside him.
ላኮም ይብል ማለት ያቀድመኝ ካልወጣ ማለት
አይ ዶንት ኖት ሱፖዝድ ቱ ሜክ ኤኒ ኢሜጅ
እስልታት ከተገብሩን አይፈቀደልካን
አን ወርሺፕ ዳት ኢሜጅ
ለምስል ከተምለው አይፈቀደልኝ
ቢኮዝ ዴር ኢዝ ኦንሊ ዋን ጋድ
አናት ሀደ አምላክ ትራይስ
አን ሂስ ዲ ኦንሊ ዋን ቱ ቢ ወርሺፕድ አን ኦል ኦፍ ዳት
ሱብሚሉ ይራህ ምላህ ዝገቦ
ሶ ጋድ ዋንትስ አስ ቱ ላቭ ሂም ዊዝ አወር ሆል ሃርት
ለዚ አምላክ በሙሉ ልብና ከነፍቀረው ይዘልል
not just half of it
ፍርቁ ዘይኮነ
not just 75%
ሰዋን ሐሙሽን ይታዩን ዘይኮነ
amen time after time after time in the bible
ኩል ጊዜ ካብ ጊዜና 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 ጊዜ መጽሐፍ ቅዱስ
god says that we are supposed to love him wholeheartedly
እግዚአብሔር በሙሉ ልቡ አፍቅሮኒ ይልሉ አብዙህ ወታ
amen
amen
And maybe we think well I don't worship any other god but you know everything that takes the place of god in your heart is an idol
then kullu akindi bota amlah zosede ablukhum bota amlah hizu zello neger amlukhot khoti
it doesn't have to be the god of another religion
manalbat fut amlah kalut haymanata zemlukho amlah khawna yiyon nekdin haymanata
It can be the god of money
sendu khawni fa
or sex and lust
way sigawrk way kom aynat stayk khawni fa dilet simi
or being honored in the eyes of people
with our insalat kibrimin lay nabbay khawni fa
you understand there's a lot of things that can become an idol in our lives
suhna gari zat abhi watna taot khona na zat
But God is a jealous God and he demands that we will worship him and him alone. That he is on the throne in your heart. That you are uncompromisingly devoted to him.
ወቆጥከው ከነሐስከ ተማሳሰልካ ወይ ከተማሳመስካ መስካለሲ እናቱ ጥራይ ከተው ሙሉ ሙሉ ወቆጥስ
And do not let other things
ካለ ነገራት ከአቱኻ
steal that devotion
አትዮክ ሰርቆ ያትናትኩ ተበግሶ ሰርቆ አዘይምካ
That's supposed to go to him alone
እትነበጉ ጥራይ ከሆነ ቦ ከይሰራው ቆም እንጠቃ
Amen There's another thing also that's connected to God being a jealous God. And that has to do with salvation and justice. If we go to Isaiah chapter
9,
the Bible says in verse
7,
this is a prophecy about Jesus, and it says, His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time onward and forevermore. The seal of the Lord of hosts will do this.
إسحاق نعرف شعاته كاتس شعاتين على نبرز لنا بفردن بتذكر كحدي خصال العالم من أنتي خزن عن كأمانسي عبدان داويتن أمن استن أبيت بذاتهم سلام مور دعتي منهم كنعت إذا أبيه قوي تسراويت نزي خكبر إيمي.
Amen.
Amen.
So God is full of zeal. You know, passion. And this is a passion for the salvation of his people. It's also a passion for justice and righteousness. You know, when the people of Israel were crying out to God in Egypt, they were slaves, being oppressed by Pharaoh. But they cried to God, and it says that God heard their cry, and he saw this unjust situation. And he stepped down to do something about it. He stepped down to deliver his people out of the slavery in Egypt. Because God is a God that is passionate for justice. He's passionate to help the poor, the weak, the sick. Kids without parents. Widows. People from other countries. God is passionate about justice. And righteousness. And he's a God that works for the salvation of his people. Amen. So there's many stories in the Bible where people are being oppressed and depressed in different ways. But then it says that God, being a jealous God, something is stirred up in him. A compassion for his people. And that thing is the turning point in the whole story. Do you understand what I'm trying to say? When God's passion is awakened, that means salvation and justice for his people. Amen. Amen. We have the book of Joel. And that the land is desolate. It's laid waste. It's a desolate land, like the no rain and no seed and no grain. But then it says, I will read it to you from Joel 2 and 18. It says that then the Lord became jealous for his land and had pity on his people. And this is the turning point in the whole book. Before this, everything was bad. Things were going bad in the wrong direction. But here it says that God became jealous for his land and had pity on his people. And because of that, everything turns around. Things are starting to go well. The people is blessed. The land is prospering again. Amen. Do you see what I'm trying to say? God is a consuming fire. And he's a jealous God. But that's not something bad. It means that he's passionate and engaged for his people to save them and restore them. Amen. So you should be happy that God is a jealous God. But at the same time you should fear him. Because he doesn't want you to have any other God than him. It's him and him only. Or nothing at all. Amen. So God has a strong passion for his people. But he has also a strong passion for his own glory, his own name. Amen. We'll go to Isaiah chapter 48. Verse 9, 10 and 11. There God says, for my name's sake I defer my anger, for the sake of my praise I restrain it for you, so that I may not cut you off. See, I have refined you, but not like silver. I have tested you in the furnace of adversity. For my own sake I do it. For why should my name be profaned? My glory I will not give to another.
Amen.
So God is saving his people. It says, for his name's sake, he will take away the anger. He will save them, he will purify them. But he's doing it for his own glory. Amen. He's doing it for his own sake. And this is, you know, God is like this. He's aware of himself. He's aware of himself being God. And he knows that there's no other God like him. He knows that he's the only eternal one. He knows that he is the creator of heaven and earth. That everything else comes from him. That he is the only one that existed forever. Everything else is created by him. The earth, humans, angels, even the fallen angels, they come from him originally. Amen. So God is fully aware that He is God. Amen. And He has the right to be glorified. He has the right to be praised. And He knows that. And it's not that He's boasting. Because He's God. He's the only one that can act in this way. You understand? They're because He's not boasting, He's just telling it the way it is. And He's the only one that should be praised. So when He is saving, when He is doing things for us, at the same time, He's doing it to glorify Himself in us. This is the way God is. And we need to realize it. Amen. Amen. God is passionate for you. But He's also passionate for Himself. Amen. And He's saving you. Because when He's saving you, that brings Him glory also. And He wants you to be a worshiper. You are created to be a worshiper. And when you are being saved, His purposes for your life is being restored. You being saved means that you are being a worshiper again. Instead of worshiping yourself or your sins or other gods, now you are worshiping the true and living God. Because He has saved you. Amen? Amen. You know, these things are hard to talk about. They're even harder to talk about with Swedish people. But I think you get this. God is a passionate fire. Amen. Number two. The first one was God being a jealous God. Number two is God being a holy God. Amen. Amen. And we're talking about what it means that God is a consuming fire. So now we go to Isaiah chapter 6. Because this is one of the best stories ever in the Bible when you're going to speak about the holiness of God.
Amen.
Amen. And I will read verse 1-8. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne, high and lofty, and the hem of His robe filled the temple. Seraphs were in attendance above Him. Each had six wings. With two they covered their faces, and with two they covered their feet, and with two they flew. And one called to another and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of His glory." The pivots on the thresholds shook at the voices of those who called, and the house filled with smoke. And I said, "Woe is me, I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips. Yet my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." Then one of the seraphs flew to me, holding a live coal that had been taken from the altar with a pair of tongs. The seraph touched my mouth with it and said, "Now that this has touched your lips, your guilt has departed and your sin is blotted out." Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send? and who will go for us? And I said, here am I, send me.
إسحاق ما أعرفش كشتر كده أصحاب إسحاق عشان مونته. بس أنا بس جزء من موتنا عملت أنا إخزي أبير أبر لي خن لعل زبالة زفان طقم بتوخن لو بإخوة. زفرات بسخاء نت مقدس مليه ونبرة. قبل ما يدم ما سرع في القيام ونبرو. نفس وكفهم شو بيشتغل فيه اللو. بدخلته نجات وين خدنو. بدخلته الماء نجار وين خدنو. بدخلته نفر نبرة. إذا حدا خانت حدا كدوس 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 يجزي أبيه ويتسرع ويتم كلنا ندري بخبر ملي الله إلو عده بدمت أتم زديو تمسر الدوت عن كذا تابيت من تكملت شعد ما كان عفري زرق السبع أما أكلت غنا فرز زرق السبع أنا برا لهم ويلي عين تيم نقص لك أبيه ويتسرع ويتريني لهم أفع خبركم كابتن صرافيل حدا ما وهري خبت مسوي بقول تتوسيلو عبيدو يجوزنا وين فر بوخا أكيدن كيمو إنه رزين خنا فرقة كيو على سحر حقلك حتى أتكون سريع الكابلة نمن كل أخي من كك خدل نيزم دمس زعري سمعه أنا ون إنه لا خلني بركو
Amen. Amen. So God is holy.
زعري كدوس.
كدوس. كدوس. كدوس. He's كدوس. 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 I don't know if I said that right. He's holy, holy, holy.
Kedus, kedus, kedus.
Yeah, that's right.
Yes.
You know, there's no other thing, nothing else connected to who God is that is emphasized in this way three times in the Bible. Only Him being holy, holy, holy.
زخان نجف كم زعيمة يوم تبلي ثم تحقق سين ربع ينقمال زعير كدوس 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 يقول بعهم زعجباب استقلت خالص بس عين ركب بجدك زعوق سمع زعير كزارب
and that God is holy
زعير كدوس
means that God is separate
مالت زعير فلويو مالت
he's completely different and other than the things in this world. He's holy, and therefore he is worthy to be praised. Amen. It also says in this text that God is king.
Amen.
He's seated on a throne.
أبزفانو كوفي بتقميت الله
High and lofty.
أبرخ أبزفان.
He's ruling the world.
كل عالم كا يمحد رأي مرح.
Amen. You know, no matter who's being president or king or prime minister, God is always on the throne.
زيك اسمين زلوب مرح هذا president prime minister من مخان زيك اسمين زلوب على النمالتي زي أبي كل كذي أبزفاني.
Amen. God is never falling off his throne.
كابزفان وريدو أكيد نتريد زي.
He's seated on his throne and he's ruling the world.
كل كذي أبزفان الله نمدر خارج زعل.
That doesn't mean that everything that happens is the will of God.
زي ما لاتقول كل
But it means that God has control. He's not going to lose control over the world. He knows how it will end. And He will be the everlasting King. Amen. It also means, as I said before, that He's worthy to be adored, worthy to be praised, worthy to be
worshipped.
Because He's the King of Kings. He's the Lord of Lords. And He has power. You know, a king has power. God has power. And he has more power than anyone else. He has all power. And this text says that they call Isaiah, no, these angels, these seraphs, is calling him the Lord of hosts.
That
That means that you can view God as some kind of general. He's the chief of his army. Amen. There's an English translation that translates this into God of the angel armies.
Na English turgum allo naitom sarawit malaqtsi amlah zul waytaz.
Amen. That's the God we serve.
Iza aynat amlahina nan.
That's the king we have.
Iza aynat nugus izal.
The holy God.
Qiddus amlah.
He is God of the angel armies.
Waytaz sarawit
malati. Amen. That means He has power. You don't mess with my God. Amen? You understand? Because my God has power. My God has power to deliver. My God has power to dethrone the rulers of this world if He wants to. My God can show His power like He did when He brought the Israelites out of Egypt. It says that He brought them out with a strong hand, a strong arm. Amen. You know, God has big muscles. He has a big, it's a big muscle God. Amen. You know, all those plagues that He sent to judge the gods of Egypt. That's demonstrations of His power and His might. Amen.
Amen.
So God is holy, holy, holy. He's completely perfect. Completely different than things in the world. He's king. And He has power. That's a God worthy of being served. Amen. It's not a weak God. And I want to say one more thing from this story. When Isaiah came close to God, two things happened. Number one, his sin was exposed. You see, when you come close to God, you will experience His holiness. And God's holiness is like that consuming fire that's burning, and it will expose everything unclean in you and me. It will expose our sin. And you see Isaiah, he's being terrified. Woe is me. I'm lost. Because I have unclean lips. In the holy presence of God, Isaiah saw his own sin. And he realized he needed to be forgiven and cleansed. He realized that he couldn't stand for long in the presence of God. Amen. Because sin cannot stand in the presence of God. Evil cannot stand in the presence of God. The fire of God will consume everything unclean, everything sinful.
Amen.
Amen. And there's a story in Leviticus, chapter 10, about two sons of the high priest, Aaron. And it says that they entered into the holy of holies with strange fire. And we don't really know what that means. But it wasn't something God liked. Because it says that fire went out from God and killed them. They came into the presence of God with something that was strange to God, something that was unholy, something that was unclean. And the fire of God consumed them. And after that story, Moses says that God will show himself holy to everyone that is close to him. So if you want to be close to God, you can't escape his holiness.
Amen.
The other thing I want to say about this is that, you know, Isaiah was not only exposed to his own sin, or his sin was not only exposed to him, but he was also being cleansed by the holiness of God. Isaiah didn't die. Amen. But the holy presence of God cleansed him. And I'm so fascinated by this. You know, those big angels with six wings, you know, they are huge creatures. We're small compared to those. But you know, these angels, they couldn't look straight at God's holiness. They had to cover their eyes. Amen. But Isaiah could see it. Isaiah was allowed to see God's holiness. And these angels, when they were going to take that coal, the holy coal from the altar, they had to use a tool. The angel couldn't touch it directly. He used a tong to take that burning coal. But they touched Isaiah's lips with that coal. And he didn't die. He was being purified by it. I'm getting happy when I read this. And I'm fascinated by it. That those angels, they can't look at God, they can't touch those things, but Isaiah is allowed to see God's holiness and live and even be purified by it. Amen. This is even more true now when we have Jesus. Amen. Amen. Because Jesus has been sacrificed for our sins. His blood is cleansing us. And through Jesus we can enter to the Holy of Holies. We can enter into the holy place of God. His holy presence through Jesus. How much more will we be cleansed and live when we meet God's holiness because of Jesus?
Amen.
If this could happen to Isaiah in the old covenant, how much more can it happen to you and me when we have Jesus, when we enter into God's holy presence, presence covered in the blood of the Lamb? Amen. So don't be afraid of God's holiness. Don't be afraid to come close to God. He is a consuming fire. But when you come before God, having Jesus, that holiness will only purify you. Sometimes it can be painful anyway, but it's always worth it in the long run. Amen. Are you still with me? So God is a jealous God. He's a holy God. And number three, He's a loving God. And all these things are connected to each other. As you hear when I speak, when I talk about His jealousy, I talk also a little bit about His holiness and His love. And when I'm talking about His holiness, I'm also talking about His passion, His jealousy, His love. You know, everything is connected to each other. But it's so important that we don't forget that God is love. That God is a loving God. Song of Songs says that God's fire is the fire of love. That love is a flame of fire from the Lord. Amen. When God is introducing Himself in Exodus 34, He says that He is a merciful and gracious God. That is slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness.
Verse 6.
But the Lord proclaimed to him, the Lord. Amen. Some people think that God is only angry in the Old Testament, and then in the New Testament He turns into a very loving and nice God. But God is the same. He is both loving and holy in the Old Testament, and He's loving and holy in the New Testament.
Amen.
So here we see that when God is introducing Himself to Moses,
ስለዚህ ሙሴ ራሱ ገልጸሉ ካለው እግዚአብሔር አዝነሪው ማለት ማን ሙሐመድ ገልጸሉ ካለው
He says that he's merciful and gracious.
ማህረን ጸጋው ሙሐመድ ገልጸሉ
Slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness.
ንሁራ ደምባይ ሙሐመድ ገልጸሉ መልሱ ካለ በአል ብዙ ለውሃት ሐቅ
So this is a loving God.
ስለዚህ ፈቃር አምላክ
This is a very loving God.
አዚው ፈቃር
It's like in the center of God's heart.
Isn't that what it amma khad lib egziabier si?
There's only love and grace.
Fuqran tsaqan tara yizallo.
You know it's covered with holiness and might in everything.
Bigdamu bqaddisnu bahaynu sultanu galab istakhallala ay malati.
He has all those things.
Kullu allo wazi.
But in the center of it all, he's love.
Fama khadna fuqran.
Amen.
Amen.
When his heart is being revealed, what you see is love.
ልቡን ተገልጾልኩም እግዚአብሔር ልቡን ተፈትቶልኩም ሲ ታትሪዋ አንኮ ነገር ስለሪ አማለት
Amen. And we can also go to 1 John chapter 4.
አብቀጣመ ዮሐንስ ምዕራፍ 4 ተውከን ከይነዘልኛ
So we jump from one of the first books in the Bible to one of the last books.
ካፍተን መጀመር ታስተጻፈ መጽሐፍት መጽሐፍ ቅዱስና ዘለዋ ጸልይና ሞት ዘጻፈ ለሕጂና ናይ ሞት ታስተጻፈ ካንተ ካፍተን ሞት ታስተጻፈ መጽሐፍ ካን ከያለና ማለት ቀዳማ ዮሐንስ
And in 1 John chapter 4 verse 7
ቀዳማ ዮሐንስ ምዕራፍ 4 ተጠቅሶ ሾራ
It says Beloved let us love one another because love is from God Everyone who loves is born of God and knows God
አቱ ፍቁራቴ ፍቅሪ አብካው አምላክ ያሞ ናሃር ህግና ንፋቀር ዘፍቅር ዘበለ ሁሉ ከአምላክ ስተወለደ ይፍ ናምላክ ወን ይፈልጦይ
And verse 8 Whoever does not love does not know God for God is love
ተቆስ ሸሞን ተኻ አምላክ ፍቅሪ ይሞ እተዚህ ፍቅር ናምላክ አይፈልጦኒ
God's love was revealed among us in this way God sent his only son into the world so that we might live through him.
አምላክ ቡጉመንት በህይወት ከነብሪሉ ለተሐደ ወዶን አባለን በመልአኹ እታ ፍቅሪ አምላክ ናአና በዚህ ተገልጸልና.
In this is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins.
አምላክ ባሉ ስለዘከረና በኔ ኃጢአትና መጣረ ኸወኒሉ ድማ ወዱ ስለሰደደና ይንበር ንሕና ናአምላክ ስለዘከረና ይው አይኮነ እታ ፍቅሪ በዚያ
Amen. God is love.
አምላክ ፍቅሪ ይው
And love is shown in what Jesus did for us.
እትፈራ አምላክ ካኒ በክርስቶስ ዝገበረው ድብር ተገልጸልና
Amen. That God sent his only son into the world.
አምላክ ሐደ ወዱ ናአለም ንስዳዱ
That is how God is showing his love for you and I.
ላይና አሐትምን አምላክ በዚህ ክሳ እንዴ ከንፈቅረና ፎር ገሊዙልና.
Love is not that we love God.
ፎርስን እኛ ናፍቅረና አምላክ.
But that God has loved us.
ዘይኮነሲ አምላክ ይና.
And because he has loved us, we can love him back.
በዚህ ምክንያት ስለዛ ኢየሱስ ለዘፍቀረና
Because he has loved us, we can love others with that love that we receive from him.
ንሱስ ለዘከረናው ንኻልኦት ሕዋናው ከነፍከረ ንኻልኦት ካፍታስ ተቀበልና ፍቅሪ ፍቅሪ ንኸብለ
Amen. And I want to tell you, and probably you've heard it before, but it's so important.
ነገርኩም ደለ ሓደ ነገር አለ ቅድም ሕት ሰሚዕኹም ኣኽትኾኑ ትኽእሉ ግና ግዳስ ስለዝኾነ ክደግሞ
That God desires a love relationship with you.
እግዚአብሔርስ ርክብኩም ንሱ ዘለኩም ርክብሲ ቀረባ ፍቅር ዘለዎን ክኸውን ባህግን ድሌትን አለዎ እንጥይነት አለዎ
God is not interested in you only being religious
ሃይማኖታዊ ክትኮውን ወይ ክትኮን አይደለም እግዚአብሔር ከም ይኮነ ድሌት
What he desires, what he wants, is to love you and you loving him back.
እትዝደልዮ ወይ ከሃንቀው ዝብሎ እግዚአብሔር እንታይ እሱ ከመዘከረ ካተረከስ ተመሊስ ከተፈቀረ
Amen. And the Bible says that he loves you with an everlasting love.
ከመጽሐፍ ቅዱስ ናፋ በዘላለማዊ ፍቅሪ አፍቀረኩም ይብለና
Amen. An everlasting love.
ዘላለማዊ ፍቅሪ
In Jeremiah 31 and verse 3.
በኤርምያስ 31
I've loved you with an everlasting love.
ዘላለማዊ ፍቅሪ
And Jesus says that He has loved us in the same way that the Father has loved Him. Now that's powerful. Amen. Amen. That is very, very, very powerful. Because you know the Father loves Jesus very much. Do you agree with me on that one? God the Father loves His Son Jesus very much. They are love. And probably you can't measure that love in any way. But Jesus said in the same way that the Father has loved me, I mean Jesus, He loves us. That's in John 15 verse 9. Amen. As the Father has loved me, I have loved you. And if you can agree with me that God, the Father, loves Jesus very much, then you also need to realize that He loves you in the same way. Through Jesus, the love of the Father is being available to you. And God desires that love relationship with you. That love relationship where He is your God and you are His beloved child. No matter what happens. Amen. And let me tell you one more thing. You cannot love God the way you ought to. The way you're supposed to. You cannot love God the way you're supposed to. In your own strength. In your own power. You need to first receive His amazing love to be able to love Him back with your whole heart. Amen. So if you feel, well, I don't know if I love God with my whole heart, ask God to fix it. Ask Him to reveal His love to you. Ask Him to circumcise your heart. Amen. That means ask Him to do a miracle in you. Because the Bible says that the Lord your God will circumcise your heart and the heart of your descendants so that you will love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul. You cannot love God with your whole heart. But because He first loved you, you can love. When He, you know, He can make you love Him. That's how awesome He is. And God's love is shown in Jesus. In Jesus' compassion for people. When Jesus is
demonstrating the love of God by healing people and delivering people and restoring people.
Jesus Christ is the Lord, بالفوسي بالمفتاح بالمنقاف إيوه تجلس أخلو نتمنز بخمخ قبر الله كله مالتي.
When Jesus is forgiving sins, is demonstrating the love of God.
Jesus Christ is حق الحياة تقبل كله نعفور أملاخي زقل مستنلو.
And most of all, when Jesus is dying for the world, when Jesus is giving his life for us, he is showing the love of God in a magnificent way. Amen. No one has greater love than to give his life for his friends. Jesus is manifesting that love. Amen. So God is a God of love. And salvation is his act of love. Salvation is what he's doing because he loves you. And he wants to draw you into that personal relationship with himself. Amen. So just let me summarize. The Bible says that God is a consuming fire. And I've tried to show you three ways in which that word, in which that is true. God is a fire when he is jealous. He's a fire when he's holy. And he is a loving fire. And all those three things go together in one God. Amen. Amen. And I just want to ask you, do you want this God in your life? He's not a calm God. He's not a wimp God. He's a mighty God. He's a God that will transform you. He cannot do anything else. You know, he cannot but transform you. Because he is a consuming fire. Amen. And that fire is a holy and loving fire. And he wants you to give everything to him. No other gods. Only him. Only him. Amen. Let's pray. Father, I thank you. I thank you for being the God that you say that you are. I thank you for being a holy God. Holy, holy, holy. I thank you for being a jealous God that is passionate for your glory, but also passionate for your people. I thank you that your passion can turn situations from darkness to light, from judgment to salvation, from negativity to positivity. I thank you that you are a loving God, that at the very center of your heart, there's love, there's grace, there's mercy, and you act to save us. You act to restore us. And I thank you, God, that you are a consuming fire and you want to live in our hearts. You want us to worship you in reverence and awe. You want us to fear you because you are mighty and you are holy and you are glorious and you are King that rules supremely. And you also want to consume us with your love. You want to fill us with your love, with the spirit of love. And you want to purify us from everything unclean, everything sinful, everything unholy. And Father, we ask you to do it. We want to come into your holy presence. We want to experience your love. We want to experience your holiness. And we also understand that you are a jealous God. Jealous in a positive way. And we want to serve you only. We ask you, Father, to remove every idol from our hearts. We ask you to remove every idol in our lives and in our churches. Because you are the one that is supposed to rule supremely in our lives, in our hearts, in our church, in our fellowship. You and you alone. So we praise you, Father. We praise you, Lord. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, that you are a fiery God. That you are a passionate God. And that you want to live in our lives and transform us. Make us like you. Make us like you. Give us a heart that desires holiness and love. Give us a mind that is set on holiness and love. And cleanse us from everything that is unholy and unloving. Cleanse us from everything that is not pleasing to you. In the name of Jesus, we pray. We want to be on fire for you, Jesus. And we want to be on fire for you with your kind of fire. Not strange fire. Not all unholy fire. Not some kind of fire that we can stir up in our souls. We want your fire to burn in our spirits. We want your fire to burn in us. Your love, your passion, and your holiness. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.